Welcome to this new episode of Ask Stago, the podcast dedicated to provide expert answers to your expert questions in hemostasis. I am Cécile Oquet and I'm really glad to be the co-host of this show with Audrey Carlo. Today we will be answering some questions we received from friends about how to establish and control the reference range of my essay. This question is really important because a good reference ranges are necessary for proper patient results interpretation. Hello, Audrey. Can you please tell us who will be answering to our question today?
Hello, Cécile. So today our guest is Tara Simpson. Tara is product line manager in North America for Stago, and we know that over there, the requirements from the College of American Pathologists and the clinical laboratory standards are very strong. So Tara will be able to share the expertise she needed to develop on this topic. Hello, Tara, and welcome to our Ask Stago podcast.
Hello, ladies. Thank you for having me.
Tara, let's go straight to our first question. What is actually an essay reference range?
Reference range is also sometimes called reference interval. Actually, the terminology is important here. Several reference values are measured on individual reference samples. Those values determine a reference range or reference interval. Globally speaking, the reference range is the range of normal results for the parameter you are measuring.
And sometimes it's also called normal range, but reference is probably more accurate because normal is very difficult to define in health.
Yes, you are correct, Audrey. Being normal seems a very binary way of thinking, and especially if you consider that the reference individuals you are testing are somehow showing up in your healthcare wards. This is also why the International Council of Standardization in Hematology recently published a guidance in which they clearly expressed the fact that individuals for establishing reference intervals might require specific blood draws and should not be the ones defined as normal by the laboratory, but rather clinically evaluated as healthy, such as blood donors can be.
And so these values refer somehow to normal results for an essay.
Exactly, Cécile. Results falling into the reference range can be considered as normal in the laboratory. These are not medical decision limits, clearly, though, as the lab result alone does not mean much without clinical symptoms and other biomarkers that may be measured for the diagnostic conclusion. But it helps with streamlining the laboratory activity.
Yes, for example, for results auto-validation, as we explained in a previous podcast on the rules on gene.
Exactly.
So now we know what a reference range, reference interval is. How can we determine it?
Well, there are guidance and standards that are straightforward. The key standard is the CLSI C28A3, published in 2008. Yet if you do not want to go through 72 pages of a standard, there is an article published by Donna Castellone in the IJLH in 2017, which explains the methodology to adopt for the coagulation laboratory in just 7 pages.
Yes, and Tara, this article you quote from Donna Castellone is also a source for the ICSH guidances you previously mentioned. And one of the first steps is, as we said before, how to select the individual from which samples will be drawn.
Yes, indeed, Audrey. Healthy in regards to coagulation means ensuring the absence of chronic disease, knowing if any drugs are being taken, but also whether women are using contraceptives or breastfeeding, etc.
Well, it's nothing but the regular questionnaire for blood donation.
Yes, Cécile, but there it really means that the patients found normal by the laboratory can definitely not be claimed as reference individual for this purpose.
Completely true, Audrey. But also keep in mind that if you have to establish a reference interval for elderly or children, then you might not be able to go to the blood bank for samples. So it really depends on what type of reference range you are establishing. The second tip to pay attention is the pre-analytical step.
Well, don't tell too much about it because we would do a specific podcast and I wish we would stay focused on the subject. So what is your main advice about it?
Okay, great. But then only one piece of advice. Be very attentive in your sample preparation procedure. Consistency in sample collection for all laboratory testing is key for proper establishment of a reference interval. You definitely don't want to introduce any pre-analytical variables.
And so, Tara, there is one question everyone is expecting the answer to. How many samples for this reference range determination?
Well, actually, the standard calls for a minimum of 120 individual samples, which is quite a lot, but it ensures the subsequent statistical analysis is meaningful.
Well, first thing being to inspect for presence of outliers. So the minimum of 120 individuals calls for a minimum of 120 valid results.
You are correct, Cecile. And then you have to establish the reference interval following one of three proposed techniques in the CLSI guidelines. First, if your distribution is Gaussian, then 95% of your reference values are within the interval value, plus or minus 2 standard deviation. This is your reference interval. Second, if the distribution is not normal, then you go for a non-parametric range determination. And the lower boundary is the 2.5 percentile, while the upper boundary is the 97.5 percentile.
And so there again, between the 2.5 and the 97.5 percentiles in this non-parametric reference range determination, you describe 95% of your reference population.
You are spot on, Audrey. Then the third method is called the robust method. This is really useful when, after excluding outliers, for example, you are left with fewer than 120 samples. This robust method is quite complex to explain, but very simply stated, it is a statistical method that minimizes the impact of outliers. This method determines the confidence intervals by randomizing the data set in multiple intervals and using a technique called bootstrapping.
Quite complex, but thank you for making it more easier, Taha. And still, we have the 120 samples, but it's a lot to have them, actually. So is there any way a laboratory can rely on, for example, the manufacturer reference ranges from product package inserts?
Sure, but you still have to control the reference range, as your pre-analytical conditions might be slightly different from the ones used by the kit manufacturer when they would determine them.
And for this control experiment, you first have to make sure that your assay is comparable.
Yes, completely. This is where the transference principle described in the CLSI C28A3 enters the scene. Let's consider two examples. Our first example is you're changing the methodology for one of your parameters in your laboratory. There, within your assay validation, you will have to correlate your new methodology to your old one, with samples covering as much as possible of the assay measuring range.
And yes, as the CLSI EP9A3 would recommend as well, to cover the maximum of the measuring range. But still, having this sample is sometimes challenging.
Sure. Some commercial sets of frozen plasma exist exactly for the correlation purpose. You should contact your assay provider and see what they recommend.
Okay. And then, if my new assay is well correlated to the previous one, can I reuse the reference range I was using?
Yes. There you can apply the correlation equation to transfer your reference range. The second example to consider is you are installing a new instrument in your laboratory or changing a reagent lot, but not changing the methodology itself. This is what the CLSI calls comparable analytical systems. You then again have to show this comparability. And since lot conversions happen quite frequently in the lab, you might consider purchasing those frozen samples that we referenced earlier.
Yes, because the laboratory cannot always have a plasma bank ready to use for this lot conversion or instrument comparison purposes. Qualifying and saving such plasma banks is not their first activity and where the productivity lies.
Yes, and again, don't tell too much, Cecile, as we'll also speak more in depth about lot conversion and instrument comparison later in this season of Ask Stago.
We have so many subjects to cover this year. It's going to be fun. But please, Taha, go ahead.
Thank you. When your systems are found then analytically comparable, you have to control your reference range, usually using 20 to 40 individual reference samples and checking they fall into your previously determined reference range, which is more convenient than redetermining it with 120 samples, as you can imagine.
Phew, I had not imagined we could say so many things about reference ranges, actually. Thank you so much, Taha, for this extensive exposé, as we say in French. It is now time to close this episode. Thank you all for listening. And as usual, all literature sources are listed in the podcast description. And please feel free to send us any question that you may have at our email address, ask@stago.com. We will be glad to answer it to a next episode. See you next time.
This podcast is brought to you by Stago. Diagnostics is in our blood.